Good evening. I'd like to welcome you to the JOANNE MICHAELS SHOW. I have tonight joining me three very distinguished guests. One of my favorite people in Ulster County, Don Williams, who's the district attorney of our county. Howard St. John, the chairman emeritus of Ulster Savings Bank, who has done many things in his long lifetime. And my third guest is Roy Stroud, an associate of Prepaid Legal, which is a company that specializes in legal assistance for the middle class, something I wish I had known about before I started in my divorce. Welcome, and I'd like to introduce my first guest, Don Williams. Thanks again, Don, for joining me.
It's my pleasure. Yeah. My pleasure, Joanne, for the second time.
You really are very, very nice to come out here. I know you're a busy man.
It is true, and as I told you before we went on camera, it also is, it's good for me to have a brief respite from the stresses of the job and get to speak to people and speak to the audience to try to educate them about what is happening with the criminal justice system, both the bad and the good.
Well,
so I
really want you to know how much I appreciate it and my viewers out there, because there are a few representatives, specifically legislators in the state, where the divorce laws are enacted, who have refused to come on the show to discuss these things because probably they're so ashamed of how it's been handled. New York is one of the most primitive states when it comes to the divorce laws, and my own feeling and many of my guests feel that it's because New York's lawyers make so much money off these antiquated laws. So the fact that perhaps you have nothing to hide.
I guess the best thing is to start by, as district attorney, I cannot do divorce cases.
This is true, but I mean, in your venue, so you have nothing. You're proud of your work.
I was, without making the show about me, I was brought up by parents that taught me at a very early age to just be candid and honest. And if you had something to hide, you shouldn't be in a public position. So. One of my faults may be my candor, but the way I feel about things, the way I run this office, the way I run my life, is to be direct, to be candid, without being confrontational, which can happen if you're a trial lawyer. And that way, the best thing about that is if you're honest with everyone, if you can look them in the eye and be honest, they're going to believe you. And secondly, you don't have to worry about what lie you told them 2 months ago. And honesty to me is very important, and I don't, there are bads in the system. Mm-hmm. There still are warts in the system of criminal justice, and you have to recognize them and try to correct them, try to improve them.
A lot of it seems to me, in the divorce system, a lot of the problem is you get the justice in that system which you can purchase. Now, I know in the criminal area, too. I mean, I used to believe strongly in capital punishment, but I got to tell you, in the last few years, I haven't changed a lot of my political views, but it seems as though there's another situation where people who don't have money are getting killed.
Well, the people who have
the money to buy the lawyer to get them off are not executed. I mean, Klaus von Bülow, O.J. Simpson are not sitting in death row.
Mm-hmm. O.J. Simpson, I was praying you would not go near that subject, but let's forget that for a second.
What a country we live in. I'm glad it wasn't Ulster County.
That's exactly the issue here, Joanne. You happen to be speaking to someone that experienced the very first death penalty case in New York State since it was placed back in the books. You may remember when Mike Cavanaugh was DA prior to me and I was his chief assistant that we experienced the horrible murder of a 7-year-old child by the name of Larry Whitehurst. That was the first death penalty case in New York State. And Mike, as Mike's chief assistant, Mike assigned me to prosecute that case. I can tell you in New York State, the general perception that you can buy your innocence in a death penalty case is unequivocally inaccurate. And the reason for that is, in order for legislators to pass the death penalty, they had to do it with such precision to afford the defendant every possible protection and right that other lectures from other states that have seen our statute virtually laugh at us as prosecutors, saying it is incredibly difficult to succeed. And it should be. Because if I'm an individual as a DA that is opting to take the life of another person, I believe in the death penalty. Mm-hmm. But if I do that, that individual should have every protection possible. In addition, the legislature, in passing the death penalty law, created something called the Capital Defender Office. The Capital Defender Office, Joanne, perhaps I can put this simply. Mm-hmm. As chief assistant, when I was the only person with Mike prosecuting that case, the Capital Defender Office and Larry Whitehurst had at least 10 lawyers working. Before we even got to suppression hearing, well before trial, they had filed over 100 separate motions, attached memorandums of law, volumes of appendices, and that attached there too. He received the most aggressive representation without being able to afford an attorney that I've experienced as a prosecutor for 23 years. So in New York State, it should not happen.
But that's our state.
Sure.
But look at Texas. As we speak, there's a 17, someone 25 who is being prosecuted for a crime when he was 17. I'm not saying maybe he does deserve it. I don't know, but they seem to be in the opposite direction. Yeah. You know, they seem to be handing out the death penalty left and right. I mean, that's a retarded people. I mean, you know, I just, all I'm saying is, you're right. In New York State, that is, I agree with you. I don't think our state is bad in that area. I think we're quite good. But what I'm saying is, now with DNA and all these things, look at all these people who are, because the cops were forced to get someone, whether it was Mississippi or Texas or wherever it was, these guys don't have any money, they have no access to lawyers, they end up picking up a suspect, that guy gets it. Some of these people spending 10 years in jail are getting out now because the DNA tests or whatever. That's all I'm saying is, not the guy who did the Oklahoma City bombing, I believe absolutely should have, we should have used the death penalty in that case. What I'm saying is that it is, the prospect of using it sometimes, I mean, there are a lot more innocent people that have been jailed than I knew of. And I think that's one of the things that the press has done, maybe, is gotten a lot of this information out. I don't know.
Well, you're talking about so many different things, and it would be easy for me as a prosecutor to point fingers at other jurisdictions and criticize. Do you know what?
Well, what do you think we do really well, like in Ulster County?
Well, let's start from the beginning. One of the reasons that I think that the death penalty will work in Ulster County is because, at the risk of sounding so incredibly arrogant, is because I'm district attorney, and before me was Mike Cavanaugh. Mm-hmm. And we were individuals that I simply will not opt for the death penalty on a case unless, number one, I am 110% convinced that the defendant committed the crime. If there is any doubt, whether it's reasonable doubt or a mere suspicion on my part that this individual did not commit the crime, number one, I will not elect for the death penalty. Secondly, I will not elect for the death penalty even if I am convinced beyond all doubt that the person committed the crime, unless I am also convinced that this particular crime was so aggravated, was so heinous, that it demonstrated a complete wanton disregard for human life by that individual. And if that is the case, then I'm a Catholic. I'm a human being. I'm a parent. I do not want to go through the rest of my life thinking that I could possibly take the life of an innocent human being. I don't want that. I don't want to take the life of a human being unless that individual deserves it without any reservation in my mind. When I prosecuted Larry Whitehurst, in 23 years of prosecuting, Joanne, I handled that case day in and day out for 1 1/4 years. Never in the history of Ulster County has anyone had that time to spend on a case. I believed completely that Larry Whitehurst deserved to die for what he did to that child. Mm-hmm. It was unmentionable what he did. At the same time, I'll tell you that not one evening went by that I did not wake up in a cold sweat thinking that I'm intimately involved in killing somebody. Mm-hmm. So it's a responsibility. No prosecutor takes joy in the taking of another human life. It is the extreme, exceptional case, and it should be invoked only when all other possibilities do not exist. And then when you have that case, there will be no one who will be more aggressive in seeking death than I. But I'm just the beginning of the equation, because after me, mm-hmm. there are a series of checks and balances, including a grand jury, a trial jury, a direct appeal, writs of habeas mm-hmm. corpus, that are all there to designed to ensure that innocent people are not put to death, and that people who even commit the crime are not put to death unless it is the absolute ultimate and just choice.
Yeah, well,
so
maybe
the protections are tremendous.
Yeah, maybe that's also why, you know, I think of moving out of the area to move another state. You move down south, you talk to people from New York State who live in the south, mm-hmm. and they can tell you about when some of these little things occur. Then you have a confrontation with the justice system. You sort of see how it operates. So, you know, that's an...
They pay
less taxes, but they also pay a price for that. So,
it's,
you know...
One of the worst things, unfortunately, that could have happened, but one of the best things that could have happened to all of us in law enforcement was O.J. Simpson. That case was an embarrassment. It was an embarrassment from the top to the bottom. And as a result of that, so many people in the private sector just lost faith in everything we do. At the same point, and that hurts, because the people that are in public service do not do this to get rich. They don't. My assistant DAs work exclusively round the clock under incredible stressful situations, making...
What do they make? You can tell us.
Well, with some dramatic increases that we were just mm-hmm. able to receive, a full-time assistant DA who cannot do any practice on mm-hmm. the outside, that works on an average of 50 hours a week under intense pressure, mm-hmm. makes roughly $43,000
Wait, that's with the raise they
that's
just got?
That's with the raise, sure.
What were they making last...
Initially, about 2 years ago, it was $30,000
Are you serious?
To start. Now, there's a range of people,
wow.
Joanne.
Yeah,
my chief assistant, John Prizzi, who's been with me 20 years, is close to $80,000
Uh-huh.
He's been there for over 20 years. But I have kids who are the most dedicated. I have a young man by the name of Emmanuel Naji.
Oh, I met him.
Who was from Nigeria. Born and raised in Nigeria. No contacts mm-hmm. with the United States. Discovered about SUNY New Paltz by reading a magazine article. Put himself through New Paltz College, put himself through Buffalo Law School. A young African-American who was brilliant, who was hardworking, who could write his own ticket in private practice, he decided he wanted to be a prosecutor. Emmanuel started, I think, at $24,000 back then, 10 years ago. And this is an individual who's incredibly dedicated and works hard. And he works hard not to get rich, because he will not, but he works hard because he believes in what he's doing. It's difficult for him to accept the criticism of the warts in the system. It was difficult for him to see the O.J. Simpson case.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's difficult for all of us.
Sure it is. But there are rewards there that are immense. And mm-hmm. There are rewards in our profession that far outweigh the monetary benefits that you can receive outside. Now, having said that, Joanne, I worked for over 23 years in the DA's office, 20 years as an assistant, not making much money. I'm paid well now. As DA, I'm paid well, and I have no complaints. Now I can put money aside for my kids' college education, mm-hmm. or to educate them to be plumbers and electricians,
and
whatever they want to do.
Right.
But so it is not terribly unfair. The assistants that come on understand they're not going to make much money.
Well, don't you have a revolving door because of that? Because they'll stay two or three years and then move on?
It is something that every prosecutor experiences to some extent, every DA. Because you become an assistant DA because you want to learn how to try cases. You instantly are thrown in. It's trial by combat. And you learn to try cases in 3 years. You will have more experience trying cases than the bulk of attorneys in private practice who spend a lifetime. And then it's hard to keep them on for that salary. One of the things that, I'm not certain exactly why, one of the things that we've been able to accomplish here in Ulster County that is somewhat different than other areas is our rate of turnover is not great. For some reason, you're looking at one of the people.
Yeah, well, you were with Mike Cavanaugh for 22 years,
and now 3 years as DA. And there is something that our office is like a family. We try to treat our people as family members. And sometimes now I'm the father. And it's very difficult, but I care for those people. I'm tough on them, I demand, but I also care for them. And I think that out of that loyalty and out of the rewards, I'll tell you quickly as I can and cut me off. In 1979, in March, A 15-year-old girl by the name of Christine Hughes was abducted from her mother's car in Haverstraw, New York, by two individuals from New York City. Over the course of 3 days, she was attacked repeatedly in a manner that I would not begin to describe to you or on TV. She was, at the end, bound, gagged, hogtied, and left to die. Just about 2 hours after these individuals had left her, after they had brutally and savagely attacked her for 3 days, Christine escaped. She ended up going to the state police. We identified the two individuals. They were arrested, and I was assigned the case by Mike.
But Haverstraw's Rockland County, isn't it?
She was abducted, brought up to Marlboro, New York.
Oh.
And where she was attacked over 3 days.
Okay.
Christine was reluctant to testify. She was a kid. She was a great kid. She had legitimate fears of revealing the horrible crimes that happened to her for those 3 days. Myself, members of Crime Victims Assistance, worked with Christine. I was right out of law school less than a year, 79. And we worked with her at great length, and ultimately Christine was convinced that in order to make herself feel as whole as possible, as long as to prevent these two men from committing this crime again, that she'd have to go through the trial. I'll never forget, it was the most courageous act I've seen in 23 years, the day that it came to she had to positively identify her attacker. And I was concerned. These things are not rehearsed like what you see on TV.
Yeah, I was going to say like Law
and
Order.
They're not rehearsed, no.
That's not as rehearsed.
And I didn't know what would happen. And we got up to that point, and I asked her, did she see the person after she described these incredibly brutal episodes of her life? And she said yes. She stepped down off of the witness stand, went over to the individual, Antonio Navarro, pointed right in his face and said, this is the person that destroyed my life. And why I tell you that story is they were convicted within 15 minutes of their both spending life in jail.
Okay. Without
the
parole?
They have the possibility of parole because it was not murder.
Was there a motive?
In my opinion, their motive was that they were perverts.
They just picked her
while she was waiting for her mother to shop in a grocery store. They just were individuals that are antisocial personality disorders. Anyway, to make a long story short, roughly 20 years has gone by.
Yeah.
Not a Christmas has gone by where I don't get a card from Christine Hughes thanking me and my family for helping her get back on her feet. That type of reward you can't get anywhere else in life. That's the type of thing that keeps us going. And that's all I need.
Yeah, well, that was shocking, really. Mm-hmm. But by and large, Ulster County doesn't have that kind of...
We're fortunate. We see much more today than we saw 20 years ago, but we are still fortunate that we don't experience that type of horribly violent crime that so many others do.
I mean, you know, that's something like you see on The Sopranos now in 2001.
I won't watch it.
But you know what I mean? You see that, and it's like, but that really does go on.
I thought,
well, it happens in New Jersey. Like you're telling me it happened in Ulster County 22 years ago.
Sure.
But, I'm blown away. Thanks for sharing all this with us. I mean, I didn't even know where this was all going, but that is interesting. Okay. And I'm glad to know that someone like you was there.
Because I just feel
like, yeah, but you pick the other people. I mean, the book stops there.
Yeah.
And that is really about everything, isn't it?
And these kids, the men and women that work for me are dedicated. Could they make much more in private practice? Absolutely. But this type of reward that I've expressed to you, and there are many, many more, you can't get that in private practice as readily as you can in what we do. So the rewards are different. Mm-hmm. There are sacrifices that have to be made, but no one should feel sorry for us. This is what we choose. No one straps these kids to their desks. They're there, round the clock, because they believe in what they're doing, and the rewards are incomparable.
But the pressure on their generation to work for great sums of money is greater than it was for ours. I mean, I know a lot of people our age who have very rewarding careers in fields that don't pay a lot of money, but that's like accepted. But I think that's the difference. See, young people working for less money, I think those people, a lot of them just you know, what's the world coming to? They don't have the values that are perpetrated by this society. It's a real money thing. I mean, everything.
Sure is. And well, I can't look at you in the eye and say that, my God, I this suit was from Marshalls. But at the same point, I'd like to make lots more money. I'd like to be able to not be concerned about my child's education. I'd like to be able to go to lengthy vacations in the Caribbean. But there are things that, to me and to the kids and the staff, are equally or more important.
And you all can sleep at night with a clear conscience. And there have been judges and attorneys discussed on my show that really can't. And if they can, they shouldn't. And
that's the problem, Joanne, and I've thought about this many times when we've spoken about it. The problem is that attorneys are no different than any other profession, any occupation. The bulk of the attorneys are good, hardworking people. There are some that are not. The problem is that we're in such a position of authority and power that we can do so much damage to people. And that's the problem.
Absolutely. I really have to tell you that I never knew it until I was sitting in that courtroom.
And it can happen.
And it can happen very easily.
But it's a small percentage of attorneys. It's a small percentage. They're good
people.
Well,
in my case, luckily it was just money, and it wasn't my son taken away.
Absolutely.
They took away the money unjustly,
right.
But they didn't take my kid away. And I've had guests on where the judges have taken the children for no reason. So I guess I shouldn't complain. But anyway, I thank you for coming and for telling everybody in Ulster, Dutchess, and now Manhattan. A little more about Ulster County.
My pleasure.
Side we don't
Thank
see.
That's true.
Thanks a lot, Don. Have
My
a good trip
Thanks
back
again.
To Ulster County.
Thank you. Take care.
My next guest is Howard St. John, the former CEO of Ulster Savings Bank and now the Chairman, I don't know what you do.
Emeritus.
Emeritus. But you still, I see you in the bank. I see you working very often. So you still go in and do things there. Well, I guess what I would really like to know is you come from Kingston, I know. And you went to, I guess it was Union College, I think.
I went to Hamilton College.
Hamilton College.
Yes.
But you came back to Kingston.
Yes, I did.
And worked as a lawyer, and you were DA of Ulster County?
Yes, I was.
In the 1950s?
Yes, I was elected in 1952. I used to say Eisenhower rode in my coattails.
And, you know, to me, that's a long, I mean, I was born a couple of years before that, but, you know, that's, so you, after you were DA for how long?
6 years.
And then, what did you?
Then I went back to private practice.
Okay.
And fortunately, luckily, I got elected to the Board of Trustees of then Ulster County Savings Institution.
Okay.
And served there. And then the then president retired. And they looked around at the board and they said, you're the only one with dark hair. How would you like to be president?
So how old were you when you became president of the bank?
I was 41.
That's
which in those days was considered young. Today it's not very old.
Well, to be president of the bank, I think it still is. It's still young. So, but one of the things, everywhere I've gone in Ulster County, you know, people like know you, everyone thinks you're this a wonderful individual, and everyone says, you know, have Mr. St. John on your show. What I also discovered in Woodstock, you were very much involved in the Bradley Meadows and getting that shopping center developed. I mean, and working in Woodstock, getting anything built there is not easy. So
I will vouch for that.
So that must have been an experience. What year was that built?
That was 1965.
Uh-huh.
I built that. And I've been very fortunate in my life. What happened here is another person wanted to buy that lot of Mr. Bradley for the construction of a shopping center.
Mm-hmm.
And he wouldn't sell, Mr. Bradley would not sell to this individual, but he said, I would sell to Howard St. John. Now, I never knew this man, Mr. Bradley.
Was he a Woodstock resident?
Yes, he
I
was.
Okay.
Yes, he was. So I went to him and I said, Mr. Bradley, I'd like to buy that lot. He said, okay, I'll sell it to you. And so they built Bradley Meadows Shopping Center.
Oh, which so is that's still why going. It's called. That's where everything is in Woodstock, the bank, the pharmacy. So that's why it's called Bradley Meadows, even. I didn't even know. I knew you were involved, but I didn't know. You know, everyone said, oh, yeah, that goes way back.
Well, we think it only appropriate that we should have put his name on it.
No, but when I've told people, you know, who are new to Woodstock, I'll say, oh, go to Bradley Meadows. They don't know where it is.
Yeah.
They don't know what it is. You know, so maybe in another 10 or 20 years, that whole thing won't be called that. But you know, once CVS rears its ugly head in town.
Right.
But, yeah, that's an interesting thing. But you also were involved in the building the middle-income housing or the
yes.
income housing, lower-income housing behind the post office. Wasn't
that's
that
right.
part of, you were involved in that project?
Yes, I was. My two partners felt that Woodstock really needed something for senior citizens. So we looked at the plan, government plan, and we knew we were going to have a lot of headaches. We were not going to make a lot of money, but that it was something that was needed in Woodstock.
Oh, yeah.
So we went ahead and got through the battle. We had a lot of opposition to it, which oddly enough, once the thing was done, we had everybody that was against us taking their pictures in front of the project.
No, you never hear a bad word about that place. Nobody's going to badmouth senior citizen housing, you know? So expensive to live in Woodstock, and those older people, and it's nice looking as well. You've really seen the county change in the last 35, 40 years. I mean, you've been here longer than that, but
yes,
what do you think in terms of the future about the county? I mean, banking, like for instance, I bank at your bank. Before I knew who you were, I banked at Ulster Savings Bank.
Right.
Because it seemed, after going to these other banks, these corporate banks, all bank that, you know, you deposit a check, it took 7 days to clear, they'd hassle you with that. I go to your bank, you put a check in, it's there. You know, you see the same people. It's like there's a feeling of it being a small town bank, although it's a 5-star rated bank.
Yes, it is.
I mean, it's not just some little hometown bank, and whereas these other corporate banks, you know, that all bank, and they would, every time my bank, my little bank, Rhinebeck, it would be bought out by a bigger bank, I'd change my accounts. And then finally I ended up where you are, and I didn't know you, and I just was so delighted with the bank there. I go into a bank, I'm not one of these people who does everything electronically because I don't know how. I don't have an ATM card, nothing, I do the old fashioned thing. And its tellers have been there for years, not weeks. You know, I guess it all started when Fleet took over North Star in Woodstock. I started banking in Kingston.
Yes.
That's when it started. It's a while ago.
Well, we've always considered ourselves a community bank.
Mm-hmm.
We ingrained that in our employees. I used to tell them, I don't pay your salary, our employees. The person that steps up to the teller station is the one that's paying your salary. So you better be nice to him or her.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing is, we are not owned by stockholders. Mm-hmm. We are a mutual savings bank.
Okay, what does that mean?
Well, that means there are no stockholders. The money that the bank makes is put aside as security for the future of the bank. We don't have to pay that money out to stockholders.
So it's like a co-op almost. It's owned by the people whose money is in it.
Really, that's true.
Really?
Yeah, but we're not a cooperative. We're under the banking law, and we have continued to keep ourselves locally. What happens, Joanne, as you know, when some of these big banks come in, they have no interest in the community.
None. They don't care.
Then they start charging you
fees.
$1 for this, $2 for
that.
They
were charging me 25 cents. Per check that I deposited in my account. I have all these small accounts.
Yeah.
I looked at my statement, I said, they're charging me every time I put a check into the bank. So I went, I said, this must be a mistake. And I went to the head of the bank, I said, the president. I wrote him, and then I went in, I said, you have got to be kidding. You're charging me to put a check into the bank? Oh yes, canceled everything, took everything out, and then was looking around for the bank.
Well, it'll never happen in Ulster City. I can only assure you of that.
So how do you get a five-star rating? What does that really mean? Because you have to compete with all these banks, which maybe have a lot more money because they're corporate. I mean, I don't know.
Well, the main thing is we're safe. I mean, that's a safety guide. And our surplus to cover any losses is so great that this banking organization say, that's a five-star bank. We never have to worry about losing money there. And we're proud of that.
Yeah, no, it's great. I've told a lot of people, because see, people also in Woodstock like to bank in Woodstock. But now they're banking at Fleet, you know, and they all hate it. But they complain that they don't want to go to Kingston's bank. So I said, but a lot of them are getting sick and tired of what's going on. So they were listening to me, and a couple people did open up accounts there. I don't know, it's just a different feeling when you go in there. You feel like you're stepping back into the past. You have those beautiful murals of the Hudson Valley. It's like a really old-fashioned bank. It's like the banks I remember when I was young that I used to, my mother would drag me to in our small town. You know, I mean, so it's a nice feeling like that. You know, you don't feel like you're giving your money to some impersonal corporation.
Well, the reason is, of course, I fit in nicely there when you look old-fashioned.
Well, I mean, really, to your credit, I mean, you know, most people, most of the time, they wouldn't allow anybody after a certain age to even come to the, you know.
I know.
It's interesting. So what made you decide to just keep on going and working?
Well, I think...
You must have hobbies.
Oh, sure.
And I know you have money.
Sure.
So what makes you go to work there?
Well, it's a selfish reason. I think it's good to keep my mind active.
Mm-hmm.
I know a lot of people that retire and they become bored. They don't know what to do with themselves. And I think that's an awful waste of life. If I feel I can contribute something to make other people better, happier, that makes me feel good.
Mm-hmm.
So from that point, I'm selfish. It's for my benefit.
That's good. Well, we're all benefiting from it too, I think. What I was going to ask you too is, what do you think in terms of Ulster County? You know, you've seen, I know the population hasn't changed. That's about it, numbers. It's about 22,000 people in Kingston. Not so much the county, but the city of Kingston. Where do you think things are going? I mean, what do you think about what's happening here? You know, there's been a lot of changes. I've only been here 20 years, but I've seen a lot in 20.
Yeah.
Can imagine what your perspective is. So.
Well, I'm very optimistic about mm-hmm. Ulster County. It's one of the most beautiful counties in the world. I'm not limiting it just to New York State. We have mountains, we have a river, we're close enough to New York City to get in and out.
And it's a rural
county. And it's a rural place.
I mean, Kingston's the only city in the county.
It is. So from that standpoint, I'm very optimistic. I think it's going to grow because a lot of people in New York City and around the area see this as a golden place to retire.
Mm-hmm.
So they're going to be coming up the river to live with us, and I think that's wonderful. And we do need more industry for jobs,
mm-hmm.
but I think that will follow as we go along. Yes.
Because the young people tend to leave the county to make the money that they want to make. They go to the cities and things. But that I think that's typical of many places in this country, you know?
Yes, I think so.
So I don't know that that's so terrible. Then when they slow down, they probably will come back.
Well, that happens a lot. People that go to Florida and say, well, goodbye, Ulster County. I see them on the street 6 months later. What are you doing here? Oh, we didn't know about the flies, and we didn't know how hot it was in the summer. And they'd love to come back, and we'd love to have them back.
That's great. Well, what do you think you'll be doing? I mean, what are your plans? Do you think you'll ever retire, really? I mean, or do you think what you're doing now is what you want to do? Do you play golf?
Yes. Well, never's a long time. So I never make long-term predictions. But there will come a time when I will step aside and do the things I want to do. I'm writing a book right now.
Oh, great. What is that? What kind of book?
This is a test for you. Who was the Democratic nominee for the presidency in 1904 against Theodore Roosevelt?
I was going to do that. I was thinking at first it was Smith was running it, but that's 1904. That's a way back. I have no idea.
Well, join the crowd. Nobody knew.
You're writing a book about this guy?
Yeah. His name was Alton B. Parker, and he was president of the Ulster Savings Bank. I used to say, maybe there's a chance for me yet.
Really? That is terrific. How did you research that? Was he in the city history? I mean, the Kingston?
Yes.
I just know. How come we don't have his house restored and opened as a historic site?
That's a good question. Actually, he eventually lived in Esopus. He had to stay down there. But was the surrogate of Ulster County at one time.
Really?
He was the chief judge of the Court of Appeals in New York and was internationally known at that time. And I think it's an interesting story that nobody's written about.
No,
he's a forgotten man.
But that's how many Democrats in Ulster County are forgotten men.
Well, that's true.
And there are very few women. No, that is...
So that's taking a lot of my time.
So that's interesting. Do you know, does he have descendants that are living in the area that you can draw on or that are helping you out?
Yes.
Some of the material?
He has descendants that don't live here anymore, but I knew them in my younger years. And in addition, I interviewed people who knew Judge Parker in his earlier years. I got an old lawyer who was about 93 who knew him personally.
Oh, really?
Who went to his house when he was 7 or 8. And so there are a few people.
Oh, wow. That's
that
great. Yeah, that kind of firsthand information.
Yeah,
that's great. And when you have it done, I'd be very interested in looking at it. And, I hope you have a publisher. If you don't, that you'll find one quickly.
Well, I found out that writing a book is not as easy as I thought it was.
No, it is not.
It's the digging and getting the material. That's going to be the hard part, and I think I can write all right. But
you're a lawyer, so you know how to. You're writing. You know how to write anything. No, writing. I remember my first book. I got the contract when I more than 20 years ago. Simon & Schuster published it. I had never written anything like you. I got a book contract. Write a book about the women of the baby boom generation, my generation, turning 30. And I had no idea. To do. But I just gathered the information and I put subjects for the chapters and I threw fold into each chapter had a folder and I put information in and somehow it came together.
Wonderful.
But you'll do it. You do it. When you first start, you think you're never going to do it, but it gets done somehow.
Well,
all of a sudden.
I'm pleased to learn that.
No, but it really does. I remember just staring at it sometimes and just thinking, how am I ever going to do this? Because I had never written anything, really. I wasn't a lawyer. But it does, somehow, if you're interested enough in your subject, I think this is the thing, and you feel strongly about it, it motivates you to do it.
I think
and
that's
pull it, pull it together. And I did it in the days before computer. I did it on a typewriter. So now, this you use a computer, right?
Yes, I do. Yeah. It's a lucky use a computer because it has a spell check. So at least the spelling will be correct.
Yes, this is good. Well, I'm sure a lot more will be correct. I'm sure you'll be very interested. And I would like to read that. That's amazing. Who would ever think? That's like a very interesting thing.
You think that somewhere in the Ulster County there would be something to indicate that.
I mean, I write a book on tourism with all the historic sites, the best of the Hudson Valley, and I have all these, like even that Johnston house next to the courthouse, Philip John, whatever it was, Fred Johnston house. Someplace like that, you would think they would have a photo or a plaque or something. Mm-hmm. Nothing, right?
Yes.
Yeah, it's really interesting.
I knew Fred, very interesting person. And that was an act of great generosity on his part.
He donated that.
To give that to the city of Kingston.
Yeah, that was nice. It's beautiful.
So,
right there on Wall Street, at the end of Wall Street, for those people who don't know, there's a lovely place. It's open on weekends.
Right.
And I say if you're in at the farmer's market from 9 to 2,
that's right.
Stroll over there because that's only open from 1 to 4. but which is what I did. That's how I came upon it.
Yeah.
But it's very interesting.
It is.
The house. Well, listen, thank you very much
for coming
and joining me. This is great. I've always wanted to sit down and talk to you, and it's been very interesting.
Well, I've enjoyed.
Well, I'm glad. That's how hopefully everyone there will, too. Have a nice day, and thanks again.
Will do. Thanks.
Bye-bye now. My next guest is Roy Stroud. Welcome, Roy.
Thank you.
I'm looking forward to hearing more about just what prepaid legal is. I know that it's affordable legal aid for the vast majority of us that can't afford the, you know, $200 an hour type of thing, but is this an alternative? Like if you're going through a divorce or you have some other legal problem, is this really an alternative to getting a lawyer? I mean, how does it work?
Well, actually, what it is you are getting a lawyer, but a lot of your costs are prepaid, much like...
It's like insurance?
It's kind of like insurance, but it's not considered insurance. Mm-hmm. What you do is you pay a monthly fee, and then a lot of your legal expenses are covered. For example, you get unlimited phone consultation with attorneys. So anytime you have a legal question, you don't have to consider what the cost is going to be mm-hmm. first. You can just pick up the phone, you call an 800 number, tell them what the issue is, and then an attorney that works in that area of law is going to give you a call back.
I see.
And discuss that with you.
So you do get a specialist in that area that
right.
you want. Now, how much is the monthly fee? I presume you have different packages, but...
Right. It depends on the state. In New York, it's $24 a month.
That's all?
That's it.
$24. But that's like about $300 a year, right?
Right. And basically...
And that's 1.5 hours of the lawyer's time in Ulster County.
Exactly what I was just going to say. I've recently talked to attorneys. They said... It's worth it just for the phone consultation. We give you much more than that, but just for the phone consultation, they said, just to come and sit in my office, it's going to be $250 to sit down with me for an hour, or $350. And this, you get unlimited number of issues. You can call 10 times a day, as long as you've got 10 different questions that you need to ask,
mm-hmm.
and you're going to speak to attorneys that work in that area of the law.
What is it, like AAA, where you get a code number, and you give them your number?
You have a membership number,
right,
and you call them with your membership number. And then... they're going to have the attorney call you back. You also get unlimited document review, and that includes business questions as well. So if you're a business owner and you naturally have a lot of legal questions, but a lot of times you don't want to call the attorney and pay that price, so you just make those decisions on your own, well, even your business questions are still covered under that membership.
I see.
So mm-hmm. if you have documents that need reviewing, a lot of us sign documents all the time, whether it's leasing a cell phone, getting a car, whatever it may be, we're signing a document. Attorneys write those documents, and what we do is you can fax it to the law firm. They're going to review it for you. Like we've had a lot of people that this has happened to. We're leasing a car. They go to sign the lease, and they say, "Well, I want to have my attorney review it." They send it to the attorney, and the fine print says it's going to cost $250 at the term of your lease to return the car. So the attorneys always say, "Scratch that out." You know, a lot of people may not pick up on that.
I see. That's interesting. So there you have your yearly fee.
Right.
In terms of divorce, because it's so, do you get a New York attorney in your county that participates? Because a lot of times you need somebody local.
Right.
You know, so how does that work? Like if you want to do a lot of your divorce stuff on your own,
mm-hmm.
and you have an attorney that you call, but you really need local advice, because their local attorneys would know the judges.
Right.
Like an attorney in Ulster or Dutchess would probably know most of the, you know. Can you request an attorney within a county?
You can't actually request. What you do is you call the 800 number, and then they're going to refer you to an attorney that's local.
Do you have participating attorneys in Ulster and Dutchess?
I would imagine so. I don't know exactly where all the attorneys are. There's just so many of them. Like,
mm-hmm.
for example, I have a business owner that bought a membership. She did business in Wisconsin. Called up the attorney. They said, here's an attorney in Wisconsin that knows the Wisconsin laws, and she was able to discuss that with the Wisconsin attorney. So you're always getting an attorney that is going to be close to where you are. It may not necessarily be in your county. It depends. But it's going to be a top-rated attorney as well. We only use AV and BV-rated attorneys, which is the top ratings that attorneys
can
get.
How is there a rating system?
I'm not exactly sure how that rating system works. I know that they rate each other the attorneys are based on customer service and things like that, how they're dealing with their clients. And
really?
Yeah. And
how can one get a hold of that information?
I think it's in
you know, I'll tell you something. This show, you may not be aware, but I have my own informal rating system. Mm-hmm. I mean, I get deluged with telephone calls from people
right.
who want that informal network of stuff from other clients.
Right.
But I didn't know the attorneys actually.
Yeah, there is a rating system. It's I can get that to you. I don't have it handy.
I'd be very interested
information is,
to but, have that.
But yeah, there is a place that you can access that.
Oh, great.
Information.
Okay. Because
that's the attorneys that we use. Uh-huh. So you're always getting a top-rated attorney as well. So, which is another nice thing. You know, you're talking to an attorney that's highly rated and regarded by all the other attorneys. Also, they're accountable to Prepaid Legal. So if you call an attorney, this very rarely happens, but I had it happen once with one of my clients. They called me up and said, Roy, I called the attorney. It's been 48 hours. They still haven't called me back. Mm-hmm. They're required within 48 hours to return your phone call. So I said, did you call customer service? And they said, no. I said, well, let's call customer service. Called customer service. It wasn't 15 minutes later, and the attorney was on the phone
really?
With the client.
Because when I was going through my divorce and was paying my divorce attorney $200 an hour,
right.
There were times often when he didn't call back for 2 days.
Right.
So that's interesting.
Right. They're not accountable. And
you know, you're paying $24 a month.
Right. And they're accountable.
I mean, that's really, and they're accountable, that's right. In some way. Although I have to say that having other attorneys give them a rating to the effect, it's like the, you know, the lunatics running the asylum, so to speak. I mean, I'm more interested, I guess, in the clients, what the clients say about the legal advice they get from these people.
Right.
Because other attorneys tend to want to, you know, it's a little club there. That's
right.
Part of the problem. But nevertheless, I guess you don't want to use any of that. If they say that some of their colleagues are not good, you can be sure they're awful.
Right. Right.
But anyway, that's interesting. It's very interesting. So that's really quite affordable. It would seem that a lot of people, is that a family membership, 24, or is it just one, a personal?
No, it's 20, it actually covers you and your entire family. It covers your spouse, covers your never married children up to the age of 21 that are living home, never married children up to the age of 23, full-time college students.
What about if you're single? Do you pay the same rate as the married
people? You pay the same rate, yes. That's just the way that it is. But
that's,
I mean,
terrible.
Even at $24 a month. Okay, here's another thing. They have never raised the rates on an existing member. I ran into a guy in a parking lot, was talking to him about the membership. He goes, oh, I already have it. He said, I've had it for 17 years. I said, great, what do you pay for it? He said, $7 a month. He's still paying $7
a
month. He can use it 10,000 times a year. He's still going to be paying that $7 a month.
How come you don't advertise? Your company doesn't advertise?
Because they have independent people like myself, and we go out and we just sell it that way. That also keeps the cost down. We also have, as for payment, it's automatically drafted so that bills aren't sent out. That also helps to keep the cost down. So it's automatically drafted out of a checking or credit card account.
Oh, really? You don't send the check?
We don't send bills out. We will do it on an annual basis, but not for month to month. And that way it helps keep the cost down. It also, you don't have to write a check out every month.
Yeah, because I was wondering how they can. Now, do you pay the attorneys who give the advice?
Prepaid Legal pays the attorneys. Right? They get a percentage of every membership that's sold in the state.
So
the membership base grows in the state, the attorneys, the law firms get paid more and more. Which is another good point is how can you afford to pay such a small amount and retain that type of attorney? I'm not sure exactly in New York what the attorneys make in New York. I know Texas just reached the $1 million per month mark. So every month that law firm is getting paid $1 million per month to represent the clients in the state of Texas.
How do you get, it's one thing to answer questions on the phone,
mm-hmm.
but it's another thing to have an attorney review your papers and do that. How does that work? In other words, is it just a superficial use of answering questions here and there, or is it actually somebody reviewing your case?
No, you actually fax, so if you already have paperwork, you actually just fax that in. They're going to review it for you and say, you know, you should change this, and to be looking out for your interest, they're going to tell you what you should change, and fax that document back to you. I had somebody with a lease that faxed the lease in and said, you know, this is what I want my tenant to sign. They said, well, I put this, this, and this in there as well to protect your interest. So that's, you know, that's what they're doing with the document review. Okay. You also get a will for you and your spouse. Most people I talk to, I'd say probably 90% of the people I talk to don't have a will or haven't updated it recently.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very important. I mean, I'm going through something right now where it's, believe me, it's very important to have a will in place and update it. It's very important.
Yeah, you're right. Because, like, you can have done a will, like I did years ago, but then let's say you acquire something. It's not in the will.
Right.
So you got to get it in there.
Right.
Now a lot of these simple wills are on the computer. So, you know, I know a relative who was a lawyer who did a simple will out of his computer for me.
Mm-hmm.
But, again, you got to update, you know.
Right.
I have to remember, yeah.
And right. Also, and many people I talk to have young children. Every child that gets added to your family, you need to make sure that they're covered in that will as well.
Right.
Because
that's
if
right.
you don't have a will, the state has one for you. And they will decide where your children go if you don't have that will mm-hmm. in place.
Yeah, you have to make who the guardian is in the event of,
right.
You know, a car
right.
crash or airplane, you
right.
know, whatever. That's true. I mean, you do forget that is important.
That's very important. People tell me all the time, well, I don't have anything. I said, you're putting three children in your car right now. What do you mean you don't have anything?
Yeah, right.
You know, you've got the most precious thing that you can have. And people forget that.
Yeah.
They really do.
No, it's true. What one of the things I was going to ask you is there prepaid legal in the phone book? I mean, do people just call up and they under
no,
prepaid legal?
No, they would just they would call me, or I have a website. We're actually on the website. They can go there. It's ihavelegalaccess.com is the website, and they can go right into there, and they can get a lot of free information where they'll just click on, say they're going through child custody, they mm-hmm. can go into child custody, click on it, and it will actually do a verbal presentation for them on a lot of questions
oh,
they
really?
Don't have.
That's interesting.
And also documents you want to learn how to incorporate, you can actually pull the documents, a lease, you can pull that right off, and that's all for free.
I see.
At the same time, they can go there and actually sign up for the membership
mm-hmm.
if they choose to. They can call me. You know, that's basically the way that works.
Now, you are based in Wappingers Falls?
Hopewell Junction. Right.
So that's Dutchess. But is there a representative in Ulster County, like in each county, or do you handle I mean, I'm trying to understand how they organize it.
I can sell anywhere in the United States or Canada. There are no territories.
I didn't know how that is, so if someone called the 800 number or got an 800 number off the website, if
right.
they go direct to you or if they...
Well, if they go directly to corporate, what happens is corporate
assigns
it to the people that are working the areas. So
yeah.
if somebody from New York calls, they're going to assign it to the people in New York.
I see. How many people work for this operation?
I believe there are about 600,000 associates right now.
Wow, 600,000? That's
yeah.
a lot.
Yeah. That's a lot.
But that's a lot of pieces of the pie to divide up, isn't it?
So, a lot of people don't really work it, though. You know, I do this part-time, full-time. I have a full-time job, and I do this part-time for extra income. So a lot of people decide they want to do it for part-time income, but really don't go out and do it. They're not salespeople, so they don't decide to go out and really work the business. But I've been doing very well selling memberships here. I've sold them from here to California. It's
like anybody
it's nice.
Is... A could be a customer.
Anybody.
Right.
Everybody is a customer, really. It's just we don't know it yet. In Europe, about 80% of the population has some kind of prepaid legal.
Oh, really? In Europe, they
And it's
they
been that way for a long time. It's been that way for many, many years, 60 years. And, in fact, when our company was founded back in 1972, the founder had gotten a car accident. The lady hit him head on and turned around and sued him. And he was an insurance agent. He had life insurance, health insurance. You know, all kinds of insurances, but didn't have any legal insurance, and his legal bills almost made him go bankrupt. So he started looking around and found in Europe that they had this, but in the United States there was nothing.
So he
founded this company from scratch and has taken it up to where it is today. We have
What's
over
his name?
Harlan Stonecipher. So we
Where
have,
is he from, New York?
He's Ada, Oklahoma.
Oh, from Oklahoma.
Yeah, so actually in Oklahoma there's about 2% market penetration. In the state itself, in New York, there's, I believe, less than 1% right now. People just aren't aware that it's available to you.
I never heard of it either. That's
right.
why I wanted to have you
right.
on my show.
Right. Most people are just not aware that it's available.
You know, because, especially for people like me who did their own legal work after a point, after you run out of money giving
right.
to the lawyers,
absolutely.
Which after the divorce, after the custody battle, and I still was in court
right.
fighting, I figured, how can I win? I'm to spend $200 an hour with a lawyer to keep $200 a month child support was insanity. Right. So I had to do it myself. And I luckily have friends in New York City who are partners in major law firms, so they were friends. So I'd run certain things by them.
Right.
It was my own prepaid legal,
right.
You know.
Right.
But that's what you're saying is I could have used them as almost consultants when
Absolutely.
I was putting my case together,
right.
Especially in family court,
right.
You know, which is much more amenable to people doing their own legal work.
Right, and before you ran out of money, you would have been able to retain the attorney for a 25% discount. Because in divorce, everything is discounted, depends on how much of a discount. In divorce, it would have been a 25% discount.
Off their what?
Off of their fee, whatever the fee is of the referral attorney.
I
so
see.
If you walk off the street, for example, we had a person go in for an immigration attorney. The guy told him it was going to be $1,200 to represent him. He bought a prepaid legal membership the next day and called, and they said, well, here's our referral attorney. It happened to be the same attorney. He said, because you're a member, I'll do it for $700.
Oh, I see. Now, how much is a membership?
The membership is $24 a month.
I see. There's no upfront fee.
No.
Oh, so, I mean, it does seem very reasonable.
It's absolutely reasonable.
You know, do you get a list of the attorneys beforehand in your state? Are you allowed to
no.
do
Actually,
that?
Actually, no. What you do is you call one. It's called a closed system. We have one attorney in every state, one law firm that you call. So that way, everything is going through there. It's all monitored. The phones that go into there are monitored by prepaid. They're all, if you call, the phone has to be picked up within three rings. So they're very, very much monitored as to how everything goes. And then everything's distributed throughout the state.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's the way that goes. But we, you know, we also have business plans, a lot of companies. I'm working with several large companies. Employee benefit for their employees.
Oh, that's interesting.
Because a lot of, and even smaller companies, a lot of time, who do they turn to? They turn to their boss and say, well, what do you think I should do when they have a legal situation? Because they don't have access to attorneys either. So a lot of companies are taking this as an employee benefit.
I see. No, it's a very interesting. Well, I really would look in. It's almost like I found out too late.
Never too late.
I'm taking my kid to college next week. No,
how
exactly.
old is your child?
He's 17.
17. Well, he's covered in college. So another thing that we give you is 24-hour representation. So if he's with the wrong crowd and gets picked up, say a bunch of kids are doing something, he gets picked up with them, he can call his attorney at 2:00 in the morning and have access to an attorney. So we give you the 24-hour, and basically that was brought about because of a lot of the racial profiling that's going on.
Oh, right.
So now we have 24-hour access in case those types of things happen.
Oh, I see. Well, that's a real service.
Right.
I mean, that is, yeah, I mean, he's not going to have his car out there. I keep thinking, thank goodness, you know, mm-hmm. but, you know, like you say, you never know.
He could be with the wrong crowd at the wrong time.
He could be with somebody who does have a car.
Right.
But anyway, no, that's very interesting, and it seems like we throw out so much money on things that never pan out. That $24 a month
Very
is
reasonable.
Really a reasonable, you know, if you think about $300 a year for this kind of so-called insurance, I would think of it as legal insurance,
right.
for everything. I mean, we're such a litigious society.
Right, absolutely.
That everybody has some legal matter,
right.
usually, mm-hmm. and if you think about it, that's 1 hour, an hour and a half a year of questions.
I had a man on the phone the other day, and he told me, well, I can't afford $24. He was losing his house because he couldn't pay his bills because he got fired from his job from an injury, which he was not allowed to be fired from in the first place. He's losing his house, and he's watching cable television, told me he can't afford $24. I said, what you can't afford is cable television. You know, get rid of the television and get an attorney because you're going to lose your house.
Right. No, that, you know? You're absolutely right. Well, it's very interesting, and I'm glad you came on and explained this, and I hope that, you know, people out there will at least check it out. I don't know, maybe if I will when I... Yeah, when I have the next legal question, I mean, really. And what is the website again?
It's ihavelegalaccess.com.
.com, okay.
All one word.
Oh, one word. ihavelegalaccess.com. Okay, well, thanks very much, Roy, for coming by. And, you know, I wish you a lot of luck with this. It seems that it's a good way to go. I mean, for most of us who, you know, the poor people get legal aid, the rich people can afford the attorney.
Absolutely. The 80%.
And the 80% of us in the middle get really in debt to those attorneys.
Right.
And $200 an hour mounts up pretty quickly.
Very fast.
So I remember those days. I will never forget those days. Anyway, take care and thanks a lot for coming
Thank
by.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.